are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is God's power of salvation. It's to everyone. And it's to everyone
that receives it.
For we shall have everlasting.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening. Welcome to our virtual Bible study as we study spiritual warfare, as we seek the Lord's face. I'm Ronald Bobo, pastoral ministry assistant to our senior pastor, Dr. John D. Tolbert at the Trinity Missionary Baptist Church. And I'm thankful to God for the privilege of being able to stand in his shoes this evening and to seek to teach this word on spiritual warfare. Our pastor began us on this journey last week, and we want to continue going down this path on spiritual warfare. Many times we think this is something that is for somebody else, but in fact, it is indeed for us, the people of God, not just for the preachers, it is for us, the people of God, and we're grateful to God. Before we go into the word of God this evening, let's go into a time of prayer. Father, how we thank you for the opportunity to study your word, to grow in your word, to be what you'd have us to be. Now speak to us afresh. Get honor and glory, we pray. Refresh my mind, my heart. Help me, Lord God, to break down the word of God so that the people of God can hear and eat and be filled. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for this privilege. Bless our pastor. Strengthen him. Bless our first lady. Strengthen her. Keep them. We thank you for their ministry among us. And we pray your blessing, oh God, upon each of your people who are listening and watching on today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. God bless you all. Spiritual warfare. This is something that is important and we need to take seriously. Spiritual warfare. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. I believe this is 2 Corinthians 10. I forgot to put that up there. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. This is warfare. We might look like we're just fleshly beings, but we are not simply fleshly beings. We have a body, but we are spiritual beings made in the image and likeness of God. And the enemy has decided he wanted to have warfare against the people of God. And so as a result, we've got to get ready for this. And therefore, we have to be ready for spiritual warfare. Now, we don't have warfare like everybody else. Our warfare is not carnal. It's not fleshy. It's not like the world. But it is mighty through God. It is his power, his anointing that pulls down strongholds. And that's where God has us today. And that's what God wants to speak to us about. I remember when I first came, we started talking about our prayer ministry, and I was talking about the importance of intercessors having intercessors, because this thing is about warfare, and that the enemy will come after anybody who tries to live for God, anybody who wants to be a prayer warrior, an intercessor. Anybody who wants to stand for God, the enemy's coming after you. And so don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Somebody said, oh, I'm so scared. I'm so scared. No, don't be scared. The power of God is available to you. The power of God is available to you right now. And so here's what the scripture says, and this is our text for today. And we're probably not going to finish all of this, but we're going to finish as much as we can. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. This is Paul the apostle who is speaking, who is writing here, because the church is in need of having some undergirding, recognizing that you're not in this thing on your own. It's not your power. It's not anything that you have, not your intelligence. It's all about him. Be strong, verse 10 says, in the Lord. That's the first thing you got to understand. It's not your power. How much strength do you think you have? It's not about you. It's not about your power. Sometimes we think that we're strong enough to handle whatever the enemy dishes out. You don't have strength in yourself. Have temptations ever overcome you? Even since you've been saved? Have you ever been taken to that place where you thought you said you would never go and you did anyway? Paul talks about it himself in Romans 7, verses 21 through 25. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will deliver me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thanks be unto God. He is able to do this. He said, but I myself, I find I want to do it, but I wind up doing something else. I want to be good, and this tempter is right there tempting me. Can I get a witness today? Somebody ought to be chatting that. I'm a witness. He says, in my inner being, in my inner man, in my most righteous self, as I'm thinking, I want to do it. I want to do it God's way. I want to delight God. But something else is happening. Remember those cartoons? On one shoulder, there was a little angel. Other shoulder, there was a devil. That's right. And every time the angel would try to talk to him and say the right thing, the devil on the other side starts telling him something else. And it was a major problem, because too often the person would lean in the direction of the enemy. It happens to you. It happens to me. It's happened in our lives. He said, this thing is messing with me. What a wretched man I am. And he asked the question, who will deliver me? Who will rescue me from this body that's subject to death? This flesh is a mess. This flesh will tear us down. This flesh is subject to everything around us. You have to be careful what you see. Things coming in through the eye gate, what you hear. Things coming through the ear gate. What you say, things that go out, you've got to be careful, because all of these things make up who you are, and you get impacted by stuff coming from the left and from the right and from every different direction. Thank you, God, for deliverance through Jesus. Well, here is verse 10. As we prepare for battle, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. King James says, in the power of his might. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the devil. Stand up strong against whatever he's throwing, not in your power. You are strong in his power. Now, this is his last instructions as he's going away from the disciples in Ephesus. He said, if I got to leave something with you, this is what I'm leaving you with. You've got to get ready. Be strong. Anybody ever had a long break from the gym and then you went back and what you thought you could do, because what you did before, you can't do anymore because you've allowed your muscles to kind of atrophy. They have grown flabby along the way. You've got to be strong spiritually, not physically now. You've got to be strong. You've got to grow strong. You've got to exercise your spiritual muscles. You've got to get into this word and allow this word to get on the inside of you. You've got to grow in the Lord. You've got to become a stronger person, not by your own strength. You've got to allow this daily walk Bible to become your daily exercise. You've got to have this prayer time that is set aside. Maybe you can't get online for the early morning prayer, but you ought to have some time every day when it's you and the Lord, and you get a chance to just cry out to him and seek his face and be empowered. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Now, you've got to study your enemy. Who are you fighting? Think about it. If you are fighting in the ring, you need to know who you're fighting with. Now, recently there was a match between Mike Tyson and, was it Michael Moore? I can't remember who it was. But I remember watching a little bit of it, and I was kind of bored because this was not the Mike Tyson who I remembered from before. Yeah, he would have his opponent out in the first ring so often. I think they had to tell him to slow down some. Well, if you know you're going to be in the ring with that young Mike Tyson, that's a whole different deal than that old Mike Tyson. You need to know who you're fighting. Are you listening to me? You've got to know who it is, what their strengths are, what their weaknesses are. You need to know how to fight who you're fighting. Now, that kind of wisdom and insight does not come from you. That comes from your time alone with God. As you are in the presence of the Holy Spirit, he will show you what to do. He'll speak to you and help you to understand how to go about fighting this great fight. And so while you're here and you know you've got a warfare to go through, a fight you're in, you've got to get ready for it. You've got to increase your capacity for it. Whatever it takes for you to get ready to win, that's what you have to do. Because every opponent is different. They're not all the same. And because you know that the enemy will come from the left sometimes, and sometimes from the right, sometimes from the back, sometimes from the front, you've got to be aware of his devices and understand what you need to do to get ready for the fight that's in front of you. Bishop T.D. Jakes used this phrase, it kind of made him famous. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. Somebody ought to be saying that in your spirit. You know you got some stuff that you're up against right now. You know that you've got some challenges on your job, challenges in your home, challenges with your finances, challenges from one place or another. Get ready, get ready, get ready. You've got to be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Get ready for this battle. And don't take your enemy lightly. Are you hearing me? What are we doing? We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. We are not wrestling with just anybody. Whist says in the word wrestle, pale, Paul uses a Greek athletic term. Thayer defines as follows: a contest between two in which each endeavors to throw the other, and which is decided when the victor is able to press and hold down his prostrate antagonist, namely hold him down with his hand upon his neck. When we consider that the loser in a Greek wrestling contest, listen to this, had his eyes gouged out with resulting blindness for the rest of his days, we can form some conception of the Ephesian Greeks' reaction to Paul's illustration. When he's talking about wrestling, they're talking about the loser having dire consequences. This is not playtime. You can't do anything you want to do and think it's okay and give in to everything the devil throws at you. We live in a culture that tries to make us believe there's no such thing as wrong, no such thing as evil. And the enemy is winning in this battle because we have turned our hearts away from God and turned our hearts and our minds, our flesh, unto doing whatever our flesh calls us to do. And the enemy's trying to pin you to the ground and gouge your eyes out. Are you listening to me? To destroy you and everything that you're trying to do for God. You see, you are most dangerous to the enemy when you are sold out to Jesus. Why do you think he's trying to get at you? Why do you think he comes at you from every direction? Why do you think he came at Job the way he came at Job, took 10 children from him, took all of his cattle, all of his sheep, all of his camels, killed off his servants, made him sick from head to toe with boils, had his wife to talk crazy to him. He wanted Job's witness. He said, I'll make him curse you to your face, God. Now this has been the most upright man in all the East. And everybody knew this upright man. He said, I can turn him. He wanted his witness. He wants your witness. Whatever it will take to get you to turn your heart, your mind away from Jesus, he'll try you. Mm-hmm. Don't go walking in the midst of foolish situations, dangerous situations, dangerous to you and the things that will make you trip up and fall. Don't go walking in there with your eyes closed, because the enemy knows that you're coming. He's waiting on you. He wants to destroy you, to take away your witness. He wants to shame you openly so that when people look at you, they can't hear Jesus anymore. They can't see Jesus anymore. Don't you dare compromise your witness, and you don't need to be doing that. Jesus, have mercy on us. So that your eyes are gouged out, your sight is gone, your ability to do and see as God would have you to do and see is compromised. You see, the Christians wrestling against the powers of darkness is no less desperate and fateful. This thing is serious business. Now, this reveals some very clear things to us. Number one, the forces of evil are powerful forces. Powerful. You need to write that down. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Yeah, the thrust of this verse is to stress the enormous power of evil forces which stand against the believer. Yeah, they are arrayed against us. The forces of evil are numerous. Listen, principalities, powers, rulers, they all convey the idea of a large number of evil forces who are struggling against the believer. The forces of evil are apparently organized into a government or a hierarchy of evil against principalities, powers, and rulers of this world in high places. They all point toward a ranking of spiritual forces with enormous authority. The forces of evil are the rulers of the darkness of this world. Darkness in the Bible means the ignorance of truth and reality, of the real nature and purpose of things. It's your eyes being gouged out. Now, you got to understand that this is serious. Remember when Satan was cast out? He wasn't cast out of heaven by himself. There was a great host. A third of heaven's army was cast out with him. A great host. Now you have to understand, there's still another two-thirds in God's army. Are you listening to me? And there are principalities and powers. There are thrones and dominions. Yeah. All in God's army. You not hear the words when it talks about the Lord of hosts? That's his army. Millions upon millions upon millions of angelic emissaries waiting at his disposal to be dispatched to whatever. You might remember when Elisha was standing outside of one city one day and his assistant was so bent out of shape, and he was saying, "Master, what are we going to do, my master? They're arrayed against us." He said, "Open his eyes, Lord, so he can see." And that's when he saw the heavenly host. And the word was, "There are more with us than with them." Are you listening to me? You're not by yourself. You're not in this by yourself. You against principalities, power, the rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness. That's your fight. You've got to hear that. That's your fight. And don't you dare back down. I've seen people, when someone was possessed, demonized, they became afraid. That's because they didn't understand that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You have been given power and authority to tread on serpents and scorpions, and nothing shall by any means be able to hurt you. You've been given this authority. You've been given this power. Now, here's a good question for you today. I put it in red on purpose because that's how people think they see the devil. Is there a devil? Now, some persons have always scoffed at the idea of a personal devil or demons who actually exist in a so-called spiritual world. They say, "Oh, that's craziness." They feel that, you know, I'm too educated, I'm too intelligent to believe that kind of nonsense, angels and an unseen world. They proclaim that these ideas are outdated and belong to the dark ages. That's ignorant. That's superstition. But note a significant fact. Humans are always conscious of some things we term like subconscious horrors that affect both our mind and our body. The subconscious works on us, even when we're asleep sometimes. unseen and uncontrollable forces that greatly affect his or her behavior. You know, I didn't know why I did that. Unregulated behavior that he or she cannot control, even when they know better and wills to do differently. When I would do good, evil is present with me. Cosmic forces that affect and determine your behavior. Blind faith that controls your life like a puppet. Things people talk in these terms. And the word nowadays is the universe. Yeah, the universe said. I said, the universe ain't talking. God's talking. It's not the universe. No. God made the universe. God's in control over everything he made. No. When these subconscious horrors come, when unseen and uncontrollable forces affect our behavior, when unregulated behavior comes, when people get strung out, people get habits they can't break, things happen in the atmosphere that impact us. Folk talk about when the moon is high, the tide is low. They're talking about many times the body and how we are impacted even by these things. All these things come. Don't say that you don't believe in anything except, you know, there is a God and that. No. There's some other things that are warring against us. There is evil in the world, without a doubt. God reveals to us a fact that is as clearly evident as any other single fact on earth. There is an evil force that has access to the spirit of man and can influence and enslave man and woman to do evil. He's called Satan in the Hebrew, who rules over the darkness and spiritual wickedness of this world. The only hope for the believer is to put on the whole armor of God. You're in a fight. He's Joe Lewis, Mike Tyson, Muhammad Ali, all in one. And Joe Frazier. And Joe Foreman. Yeah, he packs a wallop, y'all. And you've got to understand that you can't beat him in your own strength. You can't beat him in your own power. But aren't you glad you don't have to depend on your own strength? Aren't you glad you don't have to depend on your own power? Put on the whole armor of God. Yeah, you've been given some holy help. Listen to what the devil says. The devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee. Talking to Jesus. And the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And to whomsoever I will, I give it. Do you hear that? You see, he has been given authority in the earth. You can't handle him on your own. The Lord said to Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. He's going to grind you up. Jesus went on to tell him, though. He said, but I prayed for you, Simon, that your faith will not fail. And when you are converted, when you're turned, he said, strengthen your brothers. I want you to know, even when you've gone through some bad stuff and the enemy has knocked you down, Jesus can pick you up again. Don't you give in. Don't you give up. Now, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world, talking about little g God, that's the devil. The God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. This gospel is, that's the eyes blinded again, gouged out, can't see. They're lost. Their minds are blinded. They do not believe, will not believe. The only thing that can take those scales off the eyes, so to speak, like Paul, was the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can, your eyes can be opened. You can receive sight through him alone. And back to Ephesians 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And finally, in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, pay attention, be vigilant, get on your guard. Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. That's what he sees his job is. He is your adversary. He's made up his mind. He's coming after you. He's looking to hurt you. That's why you need Jesus. That's why you need to put on this whole armor. The Greek scholar Kenneth Wiest identifies the forces of evil this way. He talks about the principalities. They're the first ones, preeminent ones, the leaders. That's the principalities, the powers, the authorities, the demons of Satan in the lower atmosphere who constitute his kingdom in the air. This is the prince of the power of the air. Yeah. The rulers of the darkness of this world. That's Satan and his demons. They're coming down here trying to just bring darkness to everyone. The spiritual wickedness in high places, pneumatica, ponerios, opurainois, Satan and his demonic forces. They're coming after you and me, but we are not alone. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. You've got to stand. Are you listening to me? Take it up. He's not going to make you put it on. You got to take it up. This is not a request. This is somewhat of a command. Take up the whole armor. And you don't need to take it up one time and then take it off when you go to bed and never pick it up again. Every day you need to pick it up, put it on again. In this evil day that we're in the evil days that are coming, in the midst of COVID-19, in the midst of a world that's gone crazy morally, you need to put your armor on, because there are fiery darts coming at you. The enemy is trying to get to you. You need to have every bit of armor on. Go get your armor, put it on, and get ready for the fight. This is not an imaginary fight. Satan is not an imaginary foe. Jesus is not our imaginary friend. I know some people think, yeah, they just talking to the wind, talking to the ceiling. No, no, no. This is not imaginary. None of this is. This is real. And the reason many people are losing the fight is because they have never gotten into the fight. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. For some people, you can stop after the first few words. We wrestle not. Never wrestling, never fighting, never engaged. But you got to get engaged. Here's your armor. The armor of the Christian soldier. Remember that Paul was a prisoner and under constant guard when writing to the Ephesian church. He was forced to stare at the soldier's armor day in and day out. He had an ideal picture of the armor. And so that he could talk about the armor and talk about what the Christian needs to put on. This is where we are today. We are the people of God, fighting, empowered, ready for battle, They used to sing a song. Satan, I'm going to tear your kingdom down. You've been building all over this something. I can't remember that word. But Satan, we're going to tear your kingdom down. Are you ready for the fight? Are you ready to put on your armor? Somebody said, put your war clothes on. Every day, get in that word. Every day, get in his face. As you are in his face, you begin to reflect his glory. As you pray and as you read the word and then meditate upon the word, you get to hear his voice. As you hear his voice, God begins to do a new thing in you. He'll open up your eyes of understanding like you've never had them opened before. He'll make a way out of no way. When you have to fight that seemingly came out of nowhere, he'll give you everything you need for the fight. Pick it up. Get ready for the fight. Anybody remember from the wrestling shows, the guy would say, get ready to rumble. Yeah, you got to get ready. Prepare yourself. Put on the whole armor of God. We're going to stop here this evening. May the Lord bless you and keep you and give you strength. Amen. 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 All right.
Dr. Bobo.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful lesson.
Praise Jesus. Amen.
Yep. Wonderful lesson. And to look at the comments, I think they are agreeing with you and they are on fire. And
amen.
Amazing lesson. Just before you go, y'all know we got some Q&A. If you have any questions, this is your opportunity real quick. You could just put it in the comments. I know you all are cheering them on. They just want to let you know, Doc, we know that was the Holy Spirit. Amen. Pour into you. Everybody's just saying, powerful lesson. Thank you. Needed it. Powerful lesson. Thank you. Needed it. Got it. Put my clothes on. I wanted to heard you say a couple of things. I think it was Roy Jr. who was fighting.
Roy Jones Jr. Okay.
Roy Jones. Yep. And then Satan, we're going to tear your kingdom down. You've been building your kingdom all over this land.
All over this land. That's it.
Grandma would sometimes say all over this world.
Okay.
So we just wanted to help you out. We heard you. You said, I don't know what this is. So we wanted to add that in. So we got a couple of questions. Everybody, don't forget, if you have any questions, you can put it right there in the comments. I got a first question, and that is, faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So since faith comes by hearing, can fear come by hearing?
That's why, yes, you have to guard your ear gate. Yeah, and that's why you have to be in the word, because the word, as you stand on the word, it will chase that fear away. But too often, we've got other messages coming at us from other directions and other people who don't have the same kind of faith that's needed for this fight. And so I want to encourage you not to hear those other voices. Paul said to Timothy, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so that's why you've got to bathe yourself in the word. You've got to get into his presence. That's why you have to meditate. We don't do a lot of meditating, but we got to stay in his presence and let the word speak back to us. After we have spent time reading it, then go back over it. I liken it unto some of you who've been on a farm at some point in your life. When a cow eats, they have more than one stomach. And so they put they lap up with their tongues. And it's not in a chewed up state. And then after they have gotten all that they want, they go and sit down a while and they regurgitate what they had ingested. and they sit and they're chewing their cud, ruminating, I believe it's called, over and over again. And so they get it ready then for the next stomach, which gets it ready for the milk and the cheese, but it's not ready when they first take it in.
Yeah.
It's only ready later on after it goes through the process of chewing their cud. That's meditating on the word. Don't just take it one time. Take it, go back and get it, sit down with it.
Indeed. That's important because even us who are in the faith, who's in ministry, who know the word of God, if you're not careful, you will find yourself second guessing you, second guessing God, and second guessing everything that either one of you all touch. So we got to be very careful. And I'm talking to myself in this season that we have to meditate on the word of God. Oh, it'll creep. Fear will creep up on you. Here's another question. You kept saying it. I really want you to. I figured if I ask you again, you will say it even a different way. I just want to really bring this home to people who are watching this, whether it's Trinity or our first time visitors. Question is, why is it so important to put on the whole outfit? Why is it so important to put on the whole armor and not just some? Why is it important to make sure from head to toe, I got my shoes on, got my hat on, I got my shield on. Can't forget the sword. Why is it important, Doc?
The enemy won't come at you from one direction. That's why I said Mike Tyson, Muhammad Ali, Joe Frazier. I mean, you name them, all of them, he's coming from all directions. And he's got powers, principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world against spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, and if you look at the rankings of various angelic and demonic forces, they have different assignments. You know, we keep thinking of one thing, we see cherubs or cherubim and they sing and things of that nature. No. You have to remember Michael, you know, who was a warrior, Gabriel, you know, the messenger of God, who came from the very presence of God. They came with power and authority. And so we have to recognize that the enemy is coming and you need all of the help you can get. There are some people, I don't mind saying pray for me when I talk to them because I know they can get a prayer through. There are some people I'm not so sure. They go to church, but I don't know if they've got that kind of walk with God that they're going to even take the time to talk to God on my behalf. And so I need to know that there are some folk around who believe, like I believe, that God will hear and answer prayer and give us victory because the fight is real. I need somebody else who can fight with me.
Yes, sir.
I need a posse. Give me some folk who can go blow to blow with me and not going to run as soon as it gets tough.
Hootie hoo!
I need some folk who are going to be right there and say, I'm with you. I'm with you.
Now, I had a question. I think Mr. Bursey is probably asking the same thing. I want you to be practical when we talk about hitting from all different sides. We talk about the spiritual part, but spiritual translate to physical. That's how he deals with us. So it can happen with your finance. He can hit you with that, with friends. And Mr. Bursey says, can you elaborate on spiritual wickedness in high places? So we want to make it more practical. We know it's spiritual, but let's bring it practical of what that looks like or an example.
Well, there are, first of all, there are spiritual forces that come, but they often will come through a person. And sometimes they will come through people who are powerfully positioned. That's why it is important that Christians not run away from being a part of the political process.
Yes, sir.
Because if, in fact, you have only people who are unsaved in those places, they're going to do what unsaved people do, and they will hurt people. I mean, what happened in Nazi Germany should have never happened. But there was somebody they never took down, Hitler, who killed 6 million Jews plus so many others. And the crazy part was, and we saw a scary thing here in America, many in the church there went along with him. That was terrible. And when you have the church who doesn't know the difference between spiritual wickedness in high places, principalities and powers, and at the same time can't put their finger on what is good versus what's bad, we're in trouble there. And so I try to get people who have the ability, go for those offices, because it shouldn't only be those evil folk in those positions.
I have another question, but I think you kind of addressed it, but I want to read it. You might have something else to elaborate. Dr. Newsom says, thank you, Dr. Bobo. There are so many distractions and things to keep us from really chewing on the word. Can you give some examples of the forces of evils that you talked about? They seem kind of the same, but I'm sure there are different principalities, powers, rulers. Can you break that down of principalities, powers, rulers?
That was a part of the lesson I didn't go on because I was trying to be mindful of time.
Yes, sir.
First of all, chewing on the word, many distractions. Jesus had to get up early in the morning. He got up and stayed up late sometimes, not to watch a movie or to make sure he got the news from man. He wanted to hear from God. And so the sacrifice that we need to make, sometimes we're not willing to sacrifice in order to get to that, okay? Then on to the next part. Principalities, powers, rulers. Not sure of each exact role that they are playing, but we see that there are a variety of roles. We have in the U.S. Senate, we have junior senators, we have senior senators, we have some who are over major committees or in areas of concern. Now, they're all senators, but the person who might be the chair over finance might have an extraordinary amount of sway as to what's going to happen in the nation, because if they never let it out of committee, it never gets to the floor. And so we have a variety of levels, it appears, in the spirit realm, just as we do in the physical realm. Now, I can't tell you, you know, which angel did this and which one has that, but there are evidently a variety of powerful entities who do different things at different levels. Just as in our physical realm, we have people who have a variety of things. One of my professors, he had a daughter who was developmentally challenged, and she had someone say, "Oh, your daddy is a doctor," and she said, "Yeah, but not the kind that can do you any good." You know, he was a theologian, but she was thinking only in terms of a physical doctor, right? A physician. So you have a lot of different doctors too. They have a variety of things that they do. Some might be in medicine, some might be in theology, some might be in psychology, whatever that might be. And they might have a variety of roles they play, even though they have maybe doctor in front of their name. I hope that helps a little bit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And if not, hopefully she can chime in. I have one last question, Doc, which I think can help all of us, whether it's talking to us or helping us word things to help others. Here's the question. What can you say to the believer who is struggling with their faith in this pandemic, and now they are not sure about church? And that can be broad, meaning should I even still go? Or should I attend this church? Maybe I should go somewhere else because this stuff just don't feel right. I mean, what can we say to the believer who's struggling with their faith?
I think, first of all, we have to recognize that this pandemic is, for our lifetime, unprecedented. It's been over 100 years since we've seen anything like this. And so we don't yet know how this is going to shake out, you know, for people. There are a lot of people who are depressed and are going through a very difficult time. And I understand several cases of suicidal tendencies have emerged even during this time. To the believer who is struggling, we hope and pray that once they are able to get into the midst of the people of God and worship, that they will hear it differently. You know, part of the worship experience really impacts us and changes us as well. So that I know sometimes I just can't wait to get into middle of worship. I'll turn on certain songs right now and I can worship all by myself. The intro song for this Bible study, I go there every single time. I mean, it drives me right into worship. We are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God. Well, the one we do on Sundays, you know, I'm right there. You know, we got the victory. Well, I mean, worship can make a difference. And so we've been kind of apart, separated from it, except for looking at it online to a great degree. Sometimes when you get in the presence of God's praising people, it can make all the difference in the world. It's my prayer that we can get people back into that place of worshiping God together and experiencing God in the place. I remember times when I've heard preachers preach so and choirs sing so and the worship so extraordinary, I couldn't wait to get back there again. Haven't you been there?
Yes, sir.
It's my prayer that will happen for a lot of us, that we will get to that place where we say, I just can't wait to get back into the presence of God, praising people. I want to encourage everybody who feels like I don't know what to do. Call on the Lord and ask him to give you direction. Ask the Lord to give you that zeal again that you had for worship. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Hope somebody else gets glad about that too.
Indeed. Dr. Bobo, that is all the questions that we have. Awesome lesson. I just want to remind everybody, Trinity is trying to do a good job of touching everybody. And we thank God for our leader, Dr. John D. Tolbert, of just seeing fit to do things like that. Don't forget, we are in the midst, about 12 days of Christmas, right? 12 days before Christmas. This is day 3. And why don't you just go on over after this? Once you get off, just check out our Facebook page and it'll kind of tell you what day 3 is and some different posts you can do, some scriptures to kind of help you. We're just trying to do some things that not only keep you involved, but to keep us close together. All right. So hopefully you will join this journey with us. Don't forget, 12 days before Christmas. Dr. DeBobo.
Well, Hayes, Reverend Hayes, thank you so much for helping me and facilitating. Y'all don't know what I've been through trying to get myself together on today to get all this stuff straightened out online. So thank you so much, Brother Donis Jameson. Thank you so much. Also appreciate everybody for helping me out. Let's go to God. Father, thank you for this awesome time of studying your word and being with your people. We thank you, Lord God, for this pastor who has given us this privilege on today and for his leadership and guidance for his wife and their home, Lord. We pray now that you will bless each one as they go about their evening. God, we pray blessings. Bless, strengthen, and keep us. Use us for your glory. And God, we want to say thank you this evening. Thank you, thank you, thank you for victory in Jesus. May the Lord God bless and keep each and every one of you. Amen, amen. God bless you.
Amen. Go in victory.
Amen.
Put your hands together and praise him.